Welcome to the splendor, the spectacle, the sparkling sensation, where the romance, the comedy, and the thrill of Disney fantasies come to electric life.
And as our friend Jiminy said, welcome. Welcome to the Disney Nerds Podcast, a place each week where like-minded people get together to discuss all things Disney. We'll help you get your Disney fix on. Here we go.
A Magic Kingdom proudly presents, in a million points of musical light, the magical worlds of Disney.
Hello and welcome to show number 356 of the Disney Nerds Podcast. Hey guys, how's it going? And welcome back to the show. This is Ed, and on tonight's show, this is the first trip report we've had from Walt Disney World in 4.5 months. And tonight, it's the night. For that trip report, Sam is going to help me out. Hey Sam, how's it going?
What's happening, Ed? And this is nothing about me because I didn't go, and I can't wait to ask the questions. So who else do we have?
That's right, because we're going to be grilling Jimmy. Hey, Jimmy.
Hey, how's it going?
Good, good, good. And we're going to be grilling Lisa. Hey, Lisa, how's it going?
How are we doing, Edward?
Doing well, doing well. Nice to have y'all back on the show tonight.
It's nice to
It's been a while since the four of us. What's it been? It's been almost like as long as this whole closure thing. I don't know. It's good to see everybody.
Absolutely.
Yep, no doubt, no doubt. Well, tonight we're getting together because Disney World is open, which we all know. It's been about 2-3 weeks now, and both parks are definitely open and running around. And Jimmy's just back, Lisa's been playing around, and we're going to hear all about it. Hey, guys, so how was the trip, Jimmy?
I would say different.
The understatement of the night.
I could have, that one I could have guessed.
I stick by my original recommendation before going down that people who may be planning that family vacation, that once a year family vacation or once every 2 year big family vacation, may not be a good idea to go right now. Probably better to wait until it's a more normalized experience. With that being said, as a Disney nerd and somebody that goes down multiple times a year, an annual pass holder, it was a fantastic time to go. It was hot, but it was hot last year when we went in the summer. The mask was a little bit of a pain in the butt, but you knew that going in. And to be honest with you, the worst part about it was that it was hot. So, you know, you take a little more breaks, you walk into more stores, you hop on more attractions. But I can tell you, Hollywood Studios, for example, we rode Slinky Dog Dash like 3 times in a row. Like hop off, walk right back on.
Nice.
And ride it again.
Nice.
Almost like we did for the media event there. That's how little crowds were there, were similar to that. Now, during the day, it was a little busier than that, but as the evening approached, it got very, very quiet, eerily quiet. Mm-hmm. And every park was that way. The only park I did not experience was Animal Kingdom. We were there for 4 days. Me and Ian decided to do 2 days at Magic Kingdom and not do Animal Kingdom, simply because with no lines, we didn't know. Well, first of all, Animal Kingdom closed at 6 o'clock. So it's the earliest to close. Second, they're not doing any of the shows, it was my understanding. So they're not doing Nemo or Festival of the Lion King. With the limited amount of attractions that are walk-on, I mean, how...
Oh, yeah, no doubt. That's a big part of your day, is those shows. Definitely. It takes up a lot, big chunk of time as you're at the park.
So we're thinking, how many times can you ride Expedition Everest in a row before you're just like, all right, I'm ready to go. I'm ready to do something.
No, the question is how many...
With no park hopping, I think you did the right thing, Jim.
Well, and that's the problem, park hopping.
If we had park hopping, we'd have probably done Animal Kingdom in the morning and then go hop off to like Epcot or something in the evening. Sure. But right, with no park hopping, with that not being an option, we didn't want to tie ourselves to a limited amount of attractions for the day.
Mm-hmm. Okay, now Lisa, how many times you've been in the park so far? It's been since they've been open.
I've had 3 reservations, but I've only gone twice.
Okay, and which parks?
Both times I was with Jimmy.
Oh, awesome. That's cool.
Well, then it seems like, Lisa, you need Jimmy to fly down there so that you'll go there. So if that's what it takes,
we're
Jimmy,
going
you need
tomorrow.
To go tomorrow. You're going tomorrow. Good.
I'm
glad
going to Magic Kingdom tomorrow because Angela has not done any attractions in Magic Kingdom. She came in at the end of a work day. One of the challenges for us when it comes to making park reservations is the way that the park hours work right now, we work until 5, 6, 7 o'clock at night. The only park that's open after 7 o'clock is Epcot, and it closes at 9.
Mm-hmm. Got it. It's tough.
So it makes it really challenging to really plan that out. So I made a reservation for the opening day at Epcot. And I didn't get out of work until I'd probably gone into work at 5 o'clock in the morning. I didn't get out of work until pretty close to 6 o'clock at night. And I thought, well, maybe I could swing over. And as I was driving out of the parking lot at work, I thought, no, I don't even know whether or not I'm going to be able to get out of the car when I get home. So never mind going to a park.
Right.
And I'm glad I did, because I don't know whether or not I would have gotten the experience that I got 2 days later on Friday when it was my day off. And I was able to get there. That Epcot opens at 11 a.m. I got there by 12. And I was able to have a pretty phenomenal Future World experience, followed by a pretty darn good halfway around the World Showcase experience.
And I will say Hollywood Studios is open till 8, but pass holders without a reservation, without a resort reservation, it's been really tough for them to get in Hollywood Studios.
Never going to get into there.
Yep.
So should we take it one park at a time, or how should we get through this, Ed? What do you think?
Well, first of all, let's talk about where Jimmy stayed this time around, because that is kind of a cool thing.
Yeah.
So I get to stay at Beach Club. Me and Ian we booked a studio at Beach Club.
Beach Club Villas, right?
Officially. Beach Club Villas, because the hotel is not open.
NBA.
Yacht Club. NBA is at Yacht Club, but the Beach
Club. Okay.
Beach Club is not open. Only the villas are open.
Okay.
But when we got there, we also found out we got upgraded to a 2-bedroom villa.
Ba-dum-bum.
Nice.
Fantastic, by the way.
Yeah,
saw the pictures. I mean,
it was a lot of space for just me and Ian, but we each had our own room. We each had our own bathroom, a common area where we could sit on the couch and talk at the end of the night and just drink a beer. We probably had like a 30-foot balcony overlooking the pool.
Wow.
Beautiful.
The balcony, like you could go out to the balcony from my room. You could go out to the balcony from the living area, and you could go out to the balcony from Ian's room, and it was all connected. So we just had one really long balcony that overlooked the pool. So that was really cool.
Was the pool open?
The pool by us was open, so the one in the villas. Now, Stormalong Bay, which is the feature pool, is not open, but the two smaller pools on the property are open.
Mm-hmm. Now, can you judge, like, how crowded was the hotel? Like, was it 50% populated, or the resort?
So they have it, according to one of the cast members we talked to, they have it capped at 66%. I would tell you that it was not up to 66%, though.
Right.
When we were in the lobby, if you saw one or two other families in the lobby, like when we would go to catch a bus or an Uber or whatever, or walk through the back to go to the walkway to get to the Skyway or Epcot, it was very, very quiet.
Gotcha. Okay. Well, let's follow our way through the hotel then. Did they have, or what kind of food, restaurants or things like that at the hotel? Anything?
We didn't eat anything at the hotel. The Martha's Vineyard, which is the bar there, was open till 11. And the store there that does have like some grab and go stuff, they make pastries and hot sandwiches and stuff like that, was open till 10.
Okay. And that's a DVC type store, so that you'll find that in all the DVC resorts, the way that that's set up.
Yes. Mm-hmm.
Groceries, things like that. Yes.
Yes. So we didn't eat anything. We never ate at the except for the first night we got there. We got information from the front desk on where to order pizza, and we ordered pizza from an offsite place.
Okay, that's my next question. Yeah. Are they delivering? Sure.
Yeah, so Papa John's like delivers till midnight or something like that. So we ordered there. But yeah, that was one of the interesting things, that there's really no late night places to eat.
How late is Disney Springs open till?
10.
Okay.
So the last night we were there, we were with Lisa and Angela, and we went back to the room. They went back. They went back home. But we, me and Ian, went and stopped in Martha's Vineyard at the bar. We grabbed a beer and ordered some food to go. But it was like bar food. It wasn't quite a meal.
Mm-hmm. Gotcha.
It was Jimmy food then.
It was. It was good.
There you go.
Board, you know, like a cheese, like a charcuterie board.
Yeah. It's good stuff.
Loaded tots and stuff like that.
Right, and all quality, normal, great quality and stuff like that still?
No
indication anything's going on. Okay, awesome. So now let's follow through, keep on going as far as we got to get to the parks, and we did see some pictures from the buses, but how was that situation?
The buses were really good. To tell you how quiet it was there, I think the first morning we went to Magic Kingdom, and I think there was only one other, like, family on the bus.
Mm-hmm.
So the bus is broken up into different zones. There's six zones. So, and there's multiple seats in each zone, and they're broken up with like a partition. So when you get on the bus, they tell you where you can sit anywhere in zone one, which, you know, zone one, maybe there's two sections, you know, the whole, well, there's zone one on one side and the other side of the aisle. So like me and Ian would sit across from each other.
Mm-hmm.
You know, and then it broke all the way back up to zone six. So the most they could have on there is six parties.
What was the max amount of people that you experienced on the bus, Jimmy?
That would be that first morning.
Did you have a full bus by definition?
No. Like one other family.
So when I went to Magic Kingdom on Sunday, I had the luxury of parking at the beach club and taking the bus over from there, because for those that don't know, I'm a big transportation fan. I like to experience as many options of transportation as possible. I consider them an attraction. So I was able to get on the bus, and there were three other parties in addition to just me, and I sat in zone one. One of the things I thought was unique or different is typically when you get on a Disney bus, when the bus pulls up and they drop you off, both doors open, but when they load you on, they only load you from the front. In the New World Order, I will refer to it as, if you're in the back section of the bus, they don't wheel you past zone one and zone two. They have you get on, the bus driver will put you on from the back door.
Yes.
Gotcha.
We saw that, which was a huge no-no. You could get yelled at for if you hopped on the back through into the back doors
before. The wrong way.
You got to enter through the front of the bus, which is exactly true. And I misspoke. We did have one night that me and Ian, when we left Hollywood Studios, we were going down to Disney Springs to grab dinner at Planet Hollywood. So we left Springs. We left Hollywood Studios, took a bus to Saratoga, and then just hopped off the bus and waited for the Springs bus there. And that bus did have a few more people on it. That was the only time there was more than that. That bus probably had us and two or three other parties. There was one large party right next to us. It looked like a bachelorette party or a bridal party or something that had five or six people. And they were all the way at the back of the bus, and me and Ian at that one. Yes, they made us enter through the back door, and we were right up the stairs in the first section there. Another interesting thing that we found out about the buses, we were talking to a bus driver when we were leaving Magic Kingdom, is that when they stop, like say at Magic Kingdom, and they let everybody off the bus, they have to sit there with the air conditioning on for 4 minutes.
We were wondering about that, if they exhaust and different types of like ways to clear the air type of things.
So he told us what they did was they took a bus and they filled it up with smoke.
Sure.
And then they opened the doors and let the air run and see how long it took for the smoke for the bus to be completely free of smoke. Right. And 4 minutes was the answer. So the bus completely recycles the air after 4 minutes.
How natural is that for a company who has the Carousel of Progress, where they got to clear the smoke after every scene of the kitchen at the end?
That's right.
Right.
Looks like pizza again.
I thought that was very clever. That's a great idea that they knew exactly how long it took to recirculate all the air out.
I thought two things. I thought it looks like frozen pizza again, and I also thought it's the Cheech and Chong bus, but that's a whole other story.
But that's okay. But that's like at least, you know, giving us some evidence that they're thinking and how to do this a little bit better.
Sure.
Nice.
I will tell you one, like, not, and you know, overall I thought it was a great trip, but one thing, look, so I saw Universal's processes last month in June, and I saw Disney's processes this month. And one thing I think Universal did better, and one of the things that was a little bit frustrating for me, is on the day we were at Epcot, me and Ian went over to eat at the Regal Eagle.
Right.
So you have to mobile order, period, to get to, you have to mobile order. There's cast members at the door. So I'm okay with that. I'll tell you, at Universal, so the way it worked at Universal was you would mobile order, and then you would show them that you had mobile ordered. They would let you go inside. They would seat you at a table. And then once you were at your table, you would click, hey, I'm here, and then they would deliver your food to you. At Disney, at the Regal Eagle, and this was true at Hollywood Studios as well, you have to mobile order and click I'm here, and you have to sit outside and wait until your food is ready. Then go up there and show them that your food is ready, and then they'll let you in. My issue with that was they made us sit out in the sun and wait for my order to be ready. When we got in there, there was nobody in there.
Oh, like, okay. So,
like, they could have let us in.
They're being very strict on the rules they were given, probably exactly what they were told.
Sure, but it makes more sense to me that, hey, just show me you have a mobile order. We'll sit you, and you can wait inside in the air conditioner at a table while your order is being prepared.
Right. Well, I tell you what, that kind of brings up another point I wanted to get to tonight, which is awesome. They just had a rule change yesterday where in Walt Disney World, you cannot now or anymore walk around with your mask off eating or drinking something. I think in the first week or two, basically the rule was that if you're eating or drinking, you can have your mask off. And I didn't see any evidence of this, and that's what I wanted to ask you guys about. And then they said people were basically kind of getting past wearing the masks by basically having a cup of coffee and walking around the park with the coffee or anything to eat or drink to then keep the mask off for an extended amount of time. So Disney's kind of looking at different things and they're making changes. Who's to say they might not kind of hop on the Universal Studios mobile ordering change if that's the case? Be people a bit, tell their cast members to be a little bit more flexible, perhaps.
Yeah, and look, I mean, there's ways around everything. I thought about this after, and this wasn't the case. This is what we were trying to do. But, I mean, you could order a Coke on the mobile ordering system, and your screen's going to turn purple, and it's going to say your order's ready, and you can walk in and go get a table and then do a subsequent order there. I mean, that's not what we did. We were actually ordering food. Mm-hmm. It was a little frustrating that they made us sit outside for 15 minutes in the sun waiting for our food to be ready when there was empty tables and the air conditioner inside.
So now, after mobile ordering and then you got your food delivered to you, were you eating inside the restaurant at the table then? Or did you leave?
You pick up your food.
So you're okay. So
the mobile order. With mobile order, once your food is ready, it'll tell you what window to go to, and then windows are all numbered, and you go to that window, and they hand it to you. And then, then you can go sit down at a table.
So all of the pickups were mobile order. It's not like the one on the right-hand side. The entire Regal Eagle was mobile order.
Correct.
Okay, cool.
I am sure there's some type of contingency for, you know, the little old man or lady that has a flip phone and cannot mobile order.
Right.
That at Universal they had a register and that they would escort them up to if there was just no possible way from the mobile order. I didn't see that at Disney, but I'm sure there's some contingency because not every person can mobile order.
Sure. Right. And they're never going to say no to a dollar, so there's always a way.
That's right.
And you can't not feed the people just because they don't have a smartphone.
Right.
That's right.
Right.
Yep. Yeah.
Let me step back one quick second. So, Jimmy, we talked about the bus. You mentioned Uber. Was there anything interesting about that experience? Was it same as usual?
The Uber. So here's in Disney. Well, in Orlando, in Florida, masks are not required.
Mm-hmm.
Some counties they are, but so the Uber app tells you whether or not your driver will be wearing a mask or not, which it always seems they were. You cannot sit in the front seat with the Uber driver.
Okay.
That is something to consider if you're
If
you have more than two, like the last night we were there, we're at the
Unique experience I wasn't used to.
The with Lisa and Angela, and we had to go. Lisa was parked at Beach Club, so we had to get from the Wave to Beach Club, and there was four of us, so we had to do an Uber XL.
Got it.
I was
parked at the Beach Club, but Angela came and joined us from work, and we went over to we went over to the Grand Floridian, and then we went over to, we were on our way over to the Wave, and we look up and we go, well, there's no way for us to get back to the Ticket and Transportation Center now, because right. they had shut down any access to the Ticket and Transportation Center at 8 o'clock.
Yep, because the park closes at 7.
Sure, you had to rethink everything. So we are going to the parks. What park do you guys want to start at? And I guess what we want to hear about is what was different or how it changed, and also how did the method of getting in the parks work out?
So our first day there was Magic Kingdom. I can tell you, first of all, me and Ian did just about everything in Magic Kingdom on our first day.
Was there anything noticeably closed?
TTA, the people mover?
Right.
Mm-hmm. Was closed, but I think that we noticed that on the way out our second night when we were there with Lisa. We were walking by the noodle station. They had a bunch of scaffolding up, and they're doing some work there. So we think that's closed because of that construction. Mm-hmm. Not having to do, I don't think it has anything to do with COVID or their new operating procedure. I think it's just down because of some construction.
Gotcha.
That was the only thing I could think of that was closed. Other than the store by Splash Mountain was closed because they just don't have any merchandise.
Right.
No more towels.
So entering the park, nobody was there. So I actually did a live stream that morning from right outside the front of Magic Kingdom. I mean, the security's a little bit different because they don't go through your bag. They ask you to take out anything in your bag, that like umbrellas and battery packs and stuff like that. Mm-hmm. And you put them in one of those gray like trays. And then you walk through the metal detector with your bag, which I inevitably set off every time. So once you do that, then they bring the tray over, they scan you with the wand, they just wand you, and then they ask you to take everything out your bag, put it in the gray tray, and then they'll feel it maybe from the outside, right. And then that's it. And then it was still pretty efficient. Mm-hmm. I don't think that process is sustainable once they go to, more people coming in. Because the process was a little bit longer, right. But with nobody there, it wasn't that big of a deal.
What kind of temperature check did you guys have? Was it a walkthrough or is it a wand?
From Advent Healthcare, and they get the little thing that scans your forehead. Mm-hmm.
And don't forget, guys, who are people listening right now, you can go over to our Facebook page, the Disney Nerds Podcast Facebook page, and you'll see these videos.
And, you know, there's little tents almost like right when you get off the bus that you walk through before you get to security to do the temperature check. Mm-hmm. I can tell you, like, me and Ian walked from Beach Club to go to Epcot in the heat. It doesn't change what you're going to scan. So I know that's a concern to some people. Mm-hmm. That if you're out in the heat, you're it's going to scan higher. And it may adjust it a little bit, but they give you a little. You have to be above 100.4,
right,
for it to be excluded. So,
well, let me ask you this: for all the days you were there, getting in and out of the parks, did you see anybody being turned away?
No. Mm-hmm. Now, with that being said, literally, like, nobody's there. So
right. Gotcha.
Yeah, you're not waiting in a line. Like, not one time did I wait in a line to get my temperature checked. Every time we went, you're just basically walking through the tent. They're giving you a quick scan and moving you on your way. So I didn't witness, other than us, I didn't witness probably maybe 10 other people the whole time getting scanned, because there's just not that many people there.
Right. Okay. So Magic Kingdom, The other big thing that was being talked about, the character interactions. And we discussed that a couple shows ago about some of the things that we're doing. What did you guys experience?
Real quick, before I get to that, also the fingerprint scanners are covered.
Okay, definitely closed. So you're scanning your wristband, that's it.
Scanning your band and you're walking through, and there's like a little gray cover over the biometric scanner, so they're not even accessible.
Yeah, I would think.
Yeah, and I thought that it would just be that you'd scan and they'd tell you don't need to, like it would just automatically turn green. I was shocked by the covers.
Yeah.
And I thought it was really smart because some people are still going to, by muscle memory, still put their fingers down.
Right, automatically.
Yeah, we talked about that before. You know, when you're walking into certain attractions with the physical distancing, and it's not, sometimes it's just not, you're not thinking about it. And we've been trained for so long to fill in all available space. And
yes,
you know, so now you're not doing that anymore. We're not filling in all available space. We're socially distancing. So,
well give me an example then. Give me a standard showroom, like PhilharMagic or something like that. What do they do row by row? Muppets? How do they sit you guys?
So we did Hall of Presidents. Me, Lisa, and Ian did Hall of Presidents. And basically, they're seating every other row. And then there are blocks of seats. And then there'll be some seats that are marked where you can't sit.
Okay.
And I think they're different. Like, they're blocks of seats that are a different number. So some sections have four seats. Some have six. Some have two. So to accommodate different size parties. But I'm telling you, there's so few people there. It's not an issue. To find a seat or be distant from other people.
Right.
And that's standard through all attractions. So I went live from the Tiki Room, and it was the same thing. The row in front of me, nobody could sit in. Then the next row, somebody could sit in. Then the row beyond that. I think there were only four rows there on each side, but two of the rows were shut down. And then there was big tape all over the seating that said, you can't sit here. So there was one spot that I could sit in.
Okay. How many seats do you think per, like, section? For a family of four, five, three?
It varied.
Yeah.
They were smaller, like, family of three. There was bigger ones that maybe six people could sit in. But if there was a row where there were six people, the section to the right and to the left, the whole row in front, there was a whole gap there in front of me.
Mm-hmm. Okay. How about walking around now? Kiosks, food stands, things like that?
A lot of them were open, and I also want to go back to your character interactions.
Oh, sure. Yep.
So the first morning, me and Ian walked into Magic Kingdom. I did a little live stream right on Main Street. It was fairly empty. It was pretty interesting. But they had all the princesses up on the train station. I say all the princesses. They probably had half of the princesses up on the train station. I did some live streaming from there. And then after a while, they walked off and four more walked on. So the other half came on. So they were rotating them out. I'll tell you another thing. I really enjoyed, and I hope it stays past this craziness, is the cavalcades.
Oh, right. Yeah. I was watching those videos you sent me. They're going to be on YouTube soon, guys. You'll be able to check them out.
I thought those were really, really cool because they're not an out, so people don't line up for them. They just pop up and roll through, and it just gives you an opportunity to see some of the characters. It was also cool just to see some of, like, the princesses on the train station. They had Country Bears up on the second level in Frontierland. They had Stitch out on the stage in Tomorrowland. And he's out there dancing and messing around. And so you can take your phone out and flip around and take a kind of a selfie kind of distance from him. When we was in Galaxy's Edge, I think I sent you a video of that.
Yes. Vi,
yeah, she was up on this thing and I went and videoed her and she started talking to me.
That was pretty cool.
She over on the garage area in Galaxy's Edge?
She was up, like, close to the exit by Toy Story Land, right there to the right.
Okay.
There's some, like, had some droids and stuff underneath, I think.
Yeah, that's the garage. That's where they got like the speeders they're working on.
Yeah. She was up above that area right there. Yep. So it was cool because I was the only one. Like, I walked up and she just started talking to me, but I was the only one around talking to her. Like our friend Randy and, you know, all the people we were with kind of walked up behind us. But she was just talking to me, and we were the only people around getting that interaction. So it was really cool.
Nice. Now everything in Galaxy. Well, before we get to Galaxy's Edge and Hollywood Studios, Magic Kingdom. Anything else stand out for you guys? Other than just being able to walk on anything you wanted.
So there's a couple different ways they did sanitation for the attractions. Splash Mountain, what they would do is they would seat all the cars and run everybody through. And then when you came back, they would sanitize them and run all the cars through empty. So that sometimes, even though nobody was there, you had to wait maybe 15 minutes because they were in the process of running all the cars through empty.
Okay.
And then they would start loading them again.
Probably some other theory kind of similar to the bus air conditioning on 4 minutes, 5 minutes, whatever, after the load is done.
Now, the carousel, Prince Charming's Regal Carousel, what they did there was they had all the rows numbered. So all the rows of horses were numbered. And what they would do is they would alternate. So they would load the even row. Like when it would stop, the ride would empty. They would spray. They had pump sprayers, and they would spray the odd rows, and then they'd load the even rows. And then when it was done, they would flip, and they'd load the ones they just sanitized. They would load those and spray the other ones.
I had the experience, a similar experience over at the Jungle Cruise. So the Jungle Cruise is a kind of an interesting setup, almost like the bus, where they ask you how many are in your party. There are different sections that have larger amounts of seats available, and there are partitions in between you and the people next to you. The center row seat doesn't exist. There's no sitting in that center block. Typically, you know, they hoard you onto those boats like cattle. There's no sitting in the center block. Everybody's separated by partitions. Each party separated by partitions, and the skipper has a big partition in front of her as well. So you can hear her or him. In my case, it was a female. And you can still hear their spiel, but there's a big partition in front of you, stopping you or separating you from her.
Yeah.
While I was waiting in line, I did see them bring a boat up to the dock. Two people get on the boat, spray it down. They'd get off, they'd throw up the hand, and that boat would go off empty and dry off as they were sanitizing the boats.
I think that's almost a better system than they were doing with Splash. Like, I think they should number the boats on Splash and do evens and odds rather than shutting the whole attraction down, doing them all at once.
Right.
As you unload people, you sanitize that one and send it through empty, but then you sit the next one that had just been sanitized the ride before.
I'm curious to see what that looks like tomorrow and see if they've even updated that.
Sure. It's a learning process, so I'm sure it's constantly being changed, you know?
Exactly.
What was your question, Ed, about the carousel?
I was just going to say, I saw the video of the carousel, and to be honest with you, as it's turning around, you can barely tell that the every other row thing is going on.
Yeah.
It seemed like pretty relaxed anyway.
We went and eat the first day we were there. We went and eat at Tony's, which I'm a huge fan of now. And I've been somewhat of a fan, but the food was very good there. But I can tell you, walking around the park that first day, like, out in front of Skipper Canteen, like, they went and put out a board that said, look, seating available. So they're trying to – they're not getting enough people, excuse me, in there.
Right.
Eat here.
And they're actually doing it for their own livelihood either. Also, they don't want to have a restaurant shutting down and things like that, or taking turns probably. Basically, they had everything full-blown open, which was great.
Yeah.
Okay, so Hollywood Studios was pretty much the same. Anything else stand out as far as any of the procedures they've changed over there? Was getting into the park kind of relatively the same?
Pretty much the same. Pretty much the same. But they really need to do, and I think they're working on it, a better job with the virtual queue for Rise of the Resistance.
Right. Well, that was the one thing that I heard. I think they changed it right then and there, like the day they opened it, which kind of surprised everybody. They moved over to the virtual queue again. Did you guys get on it?
We did not. And I can tell you, now we didn't. We wasn't there first thing. We wasn't there for the 10 o'clock. We got there a little bit after 10.
Right.
But for the 1 o'clock, me and Ian both were requesting it at before 1:01.
So what they did, let's step back a second. What had been happening, you got there when the park opened before rope drop, and they did a virtual queue, and everybody tried to get for the day. Right. Then post-pandemic, it's you do it at 10 a.m. and then again at 1 and then again at 4. There were 3-time slots, and now they've gone to 2. Is that what's going on?
That's correct. And actually, post-pandemic, the original thought process was they were going to do a line, just a standby line.
Right.
And then they opened up for cast member previews, and the line got up to like 2 hours.
Yeah, and everyone went there.
So I think from that they said, you know what, we can't if we're getting 2 hour lines just for the cast member preview.
Right.
That's just not going to work. So they went to the virtual queue. Now, it's my understanding, the day we were there at 1 o'clock, we tried, and me and Ian both tried to get boarding passes at before 1:01. Within 10 seconds, we were hitting the button and nothing. And then at 4 o'clock, the same thing. And we got backup group 68. Ian ended up getting.
And see, now that's ridiculous. Considering there's nobody in the park, what the hell?
So, and then later on, we got a notification that we wouldn't be boarded. So it was my understanding, though, that the ride went down twice for over 2 hours. So all the people that had boarding groups from the 10 o'clock slot
went to the 1 o'clock.
Got pushed back. So they didn't even give any availability in the 1 o'clock slot. It didn't matter how fast you were. Gotcha. There was nothing there for you to get.
Okay. At least there was a reason, but still, boy, that sucks.
Yeah, that stinks.
That's frustrating. It's frustrating when you plan your day to go to Hollywood Studios.
Sure. To do that.
Studios.
Your one day, because that's the only park you can go to that day. It's not like you could jump on the Skyliner and head over to Epcot, right?
Right. It's not like, right. It'd be one thing if you were there at, you know, 4 o'clock and you said, darn it, didn't get a boarding group. Oh, well, let's go hop on the Skyliner and go to Epcot. No.
Which is exactly what I did multiple times.
Yeah, so you're stuck there. Now, I will tell you one cool thing is on Smuggler's Run, there was no wait either time.
Well, that was my next question to you, too, was how that one went. So how did you guys do? Do any better without the rogue crew members?
We did. We definitely did. So we went once. Me and Ian went once. And it was just me and him. And we got to both be pilots. So because they're only doing one group per little cabin.
Wow, perfect.
And then later that day, we went again, and there were 6 of us. It was me and Ian and our friend Randy, his wife, and...
So you had a full crew.
So we had a full crew.
See, that's the thing. A full crew of people you know, that's like the best.
We tried to get it into Chewbacca mode.
Chewie mode.
But somebody screwed. One of the kids screwed up.
That's assuming that I've never seen it yet. Yeah, I'd love to see that someday.
You
need to get 6 people that know exactly what to do and when to do it.
Yes,
right. That's
it.
Do it before you start. But when you get it right, it's cool. Because
you get a couple of kids on there, you get excited. I get excited when I get on there. I forget what I'm supposed to do.
Still, we still did well. We still, you know, it was still fun having everybody on there. But
right,
yeah,
very good. But yeah, it'd be cool if we get like 6 of us to fill it and get it in the Chewy mode.
Something to shoot for. Lisa, you were there 2 days. What parks did you go to? Magic Kingdom and what?
Epcot.
Okay. Well, let's finish up Hollywood Studios and jump over to Epcot then. Anything else really stick out? I mean, Hollywood Studios itself is just getting back on its feet with everything, Galaxy's Edge opening and stuff like that. Animation Courtyard, anything changing in there Star Wars-wise? Or did you get in there?
Launch Bay was closed.
Okay.
Well, take that back. It was open. But it was all of Launch Bay was a relaxation area. Which means you could go in there and take your, there were spots, there were like dots on the floor that you, as long as you're on your dot, you could take your mask off and kind of chill out. There were tables in there.
Right.
Some dots just on the floor. We got soaked. That was another thing of Galaxy's Edge is, man, they need more cover from the rain because you couldn't even get like in the quick service because you have to have a mobile order. So you can't run there to get out of the rain.
Right. And there's no real stores going on except for like the mall area.
Right. So it was.
Which isn't undercover.
I was going to say, it doesn't have like holes in the ceiling in that place too?
Yes.
It does. And so me and Ian were standing outside of like in front of Savvy's. Under one of those little triangle umbrellas, and it was,
which don't cover much.
It doesn't cover.
It's a triangle.
And it was storming. I mean, it was storming.
Well, so Florida.
This is when you realize that Galaxy's Edge was designed for California and then moved to Florida.
I'm telling you, because there is.
That's exactly what happened.
There is no cover there. So
right.
Well, the other thing that stood out about Hollywood Studios is a lot of attraction breakdowns. At one point in time, we were in line for Rock and Roller Coaster, and it broke. They kicked everybody out of the line. We looked at the app, and at that time, Rock and Roller Coaster was down, Toy Story Midway Mania was down, Slinky Dog Dash was down, and Mickey and Minnie's Runaway Railroad was down.
Well, this was like the second or third day the park was open after 4 months. I think they're kind of getting through those, like, you know, opening day gyrations, unfortunately.
Maybe. I don't. I did get to experience Mickey and Minnie's Runaway Railroad for the first time.
Nice, Jimmy. And
subsequent, I really, really enjoyed it.
Was the pre-show what it should have been? Did it feel like it was good, the pre-show?
Not doing the pre-show.
Okay. All right. So that's a little bit missing, but that's okay.
And I was, you know, Ian had been on it. He went on it in March before. Close it. So he explained some of the pre-show to me, and I won't give any spoilers.
Yeah, don't give it away because it is good. But the ride itself, it's pretty sweet, isn't it?
It's pretty. It was pretty nice.
You can ride that again and again and see something different every time, and even with the mask on, it doesn't matter. So that's one of the things. Once you get in there and get through all this stuff, it's Mickey Minnie's Runaway Railroad for crying out loud.
And there's definitely some little Easter eggs for. Great movie ride in there, which
that
is cool.
That is it. Oh, absolutely.
You know, real quick question about that ride, and we'll move on to Epcot. Can you tell that you're on the track from the Great Movie Ride, or is that just been changed a lot?
Okay.
No, that's not
at all. The first time I ever experienced it, one of the things that I was doing was trying to figure out where I was in conjunction with.
You can't.
Right.
And you really can't do
good.
It.
Good. That's how it should be.
Yeah, because you're moving forward, you're moving backwards, you're all over the place. You go into a room and go out of it, and you come back through the same room, and it's a different room.
Right.
It's cool.
Nice. Okay, so let's move on over to Epcot. Now, Lisa, getting in Epcot, did you go in the main entrance or through the boardwalk?
I came in through the main entrance. I parked in the parking lot. Came in through the main entrance just before... right underneath the monorail station is the temperature check, and then you go off to the right and go through security, and then you go through your turnstile just like normal. I was expecting something a little bit different, but all the walls are still up.
Are they?
They are.
They haven't been working.
And, you got to go left and kind of circle your way around in order to get over towards Test Track, and then you can go off to the right, and that will lead you to that back pathway by the Seas with Nemo. And then just to the left of that, to the left of that pathway, you do have access to Spaceship Earth, which was, of course, my very first stop.
And it was open. I'm asking Lisa. Spaceship Earth was open. You wrote it.
I did. I wrote it twice.
So,
Why did it close?
Wrote it again. Jimmy and at that point, Jimmy and Ian were up at the Regal Eagle, so I decided to start jumping on some attractions.
Sure.
One of the things though is I actually sat there and waited for about 20 minutes. They had shut down the queue because they had. What they're doing at Spaceship Earth is sanitizing the whole entire attraction, letting it run all the way through. And then once that first car that you sanitize comes back, that's when they load you on. And they'll
Same as Splash, yeah.
How about that?
But we get it. One fell swoop. It's one full, you know, it's an omni mover.
Yeah. True. So keep it going.
I think I feel the same way about that as Splash, though. I think they'd be better served doing every other. Well, and not stopping the line for every car to run through. Right. Then you're just being consistent and the line's moving consistently. You know, you're not going from loading almost every car to loading none.
Only thing I can think of is that's the best way to make sure you're not going to miss anything or mess up the order, what you're cleaning and not cleaning.
Look, it's not a terrible. I'm not saying it's a terrible. You know, they're getting them clean. So I mean, that's the biggest part. But
right. I'm sorry. Go ahead.
No. That's fine. I mean, it just from an attraction perspective. My next stop was Mission Space, and that was unique. Usually, when you go into Mission Space, there are 8 or 9 rows of people that you can fit in the pre-show room. I thought we would just maybe walk right through, but they still have a pre-show. But in this case, the room is made up of 1, 3, 5, 7, and 9 instead of, I think, 1 through 9 or 1 through 10.
Right.
So they've blocked you in different parts of the pre-show room.
And you did that back to back.
And you do that back to back, yep.
You rode that attraction back to back.
I rode green and then I rode orange with you. I was very selective as to what I was going to ride. I knew you weren't going to ride green. I knew you wanted to ride orange. So I said, he's going to be heading this way. I'm going to ride green right now. So that way I don't vomit all over the place riding orange.
And any issues with orange then, since you did both? That's like most people don't usually do those in one day.
Yeah, if not, this is not one after the other. I'm not doing that.
I'm all over orange.
To me, green feels like Soarin', so it's really not that big of a deal. I don't find it intense at all.
Right. Well, isn't green the nice orange one?
Yeah, green's the less intense.
But the thing with green was it's a new movie. That's the best reason to go on it.
Yeah. I've been on it.
Yep.
Once.
Yeah, and that's the same with me, just to see the new movie.
Yeah, just to see the movie. I might even have, I don't remember that. I might have done green with you. I love orange. I love that. I love getting like that. The G-forces slamming me back in my seat. I love that feeling.
Nice.
So because they're only doing that attraction at 50% capacity, they're loading every other vehicle.
So they're probably sanitizing in between, right?
And they're sanitizing the opposing one in between.
Right. Nice. So now,
then we went on a 3-hour adventure on Test Track.
What happened there?
Wait, a 3-hour tour on Test Track?
That felt like it consistently. We had a whole group of us because by that, when we walked off of Mission Space, we ran into our friends Randy, that's our friend Heidi's brother, and his family, and they were like, we just happened to run into them. I knew they were going to be at Epcot, but they were at the coffee stand or the popcorn stand right outside of Mission Space, so we walked over and talked to them, and then we all went on, a whole group of us. I think there was 7 of us on Test Track, and it broke, and we moved a little bit, and it broke again, and it moved a little bit, and we broke again.
So just enough to keep you guys like on the line, but not enough to actually keep you going.
It was enough to strangle me with the seatbelt was what it was.
Right. Okay, we're getting down time-wise for tonight's show, but Epcot-wise, how about the movie rides, the movie attractions? Canada, France, China. What was the situation with those guys?
I did not go experience any of those.
I didn't do anything. No, by the time I got into World Showcase, which I did every attraction in Future World, everyone.
Beautiful.
But by the time I got into World Showcase, I was hungry and wanted something to eat and drink.
Go ahead.
That's a segue, right? Because I'm thinking Taste of Food and Wine Festival.
The Taste of Flower and Garden.
The Taste of Flower and Food
and Wine.
Flower and Food.
I think I think I wrote everything in Tomorrowland other than Turtle Talk with Crush is the only thing I didn't experience.
It's closed.
Oh, well, Future World.
So you did write everything.
I realized there, but so I did everything. Okay. Yep. Yeah,
that's a tough one.
You didn't do Mission Space Green.
I didn't do Mission Space Green.
That doesn't count. As long as you did Mission Space.
Hey, yeah. That's not fair. I did Green.
Well, you did more complete, definitely.
Bryce, you were talking about mobile order in all of the places. How did they handle the kiosks for the festival?
Kiosks were pretty much the same, other than the fact that the cash registers were inside the booths with a plexiglass thing instead of outside by themselves.
Okay.
They had them outside, Jimmy. I think that they were inside because it had just poured.
Oh, maybe so. Maybe that's a rain contingency.
Yeah, if it
rains, I've seen them in for rain before.
They'll bump them inside.
Yeah, I mean, I think we can. I think it was overall great. Obviously, I was there drinking more than eating, but I did stop at all the booths with Lisa, Angela, and Ian. And there's some great food there, and some different things. So I think we could almost have a show about that, or at least a portion of a show. Well, just about that specifically.
And I tell you what, it's going to be around.
Nothing else. Ahead, Ian, Angela, and I are professional eaters, so we're certainly.
Did they have custom merchandise? That's what I want to know. 2020 Taste of Food and Wine Festival.
I didn't see anything like that.
It's going to be around for so long, we're going to be able to talk about this for a little while, which is cool.
Yeah.
Yeah, that is true.
Together.
We might all be able to get there. It's going until November, right?
Yeah.
Until Christmas. Right?
We should be able to experience this together in November.
Are they going
to
beef it up for Food and Wine? Like add booths? Or is
I
this
don't think it's going to change.
I think the plan was they are adding some booths.
That's what I kind of thought I heard.
Yeah, the donut stop is coming back. There are booths that are up that have a coming soon, just like they did last year.
Yeah.
Okay, now another weird question. Did the Odyssey still have the preview in there for the upcoming Epcot stuff?
We didn't go, but I did see that it is there.
Okay.
I wonder if they changed it all with some of the things that we know aren't coming now, like Mary Poppins and the Spaceship Earth redo.
Right. Well, that's interesting.
Talked about it probably not being there, and then later on that day, our friend Randy and them, they went over there, and it was still there, and he texted me. So it's still there. I don't know if it's changed, because he just texted me a picture. He didn't.
I would probably think it didn't change at this point. Those things are promised. Might not be coming. Nothing's 100% ever not going to be here.
Sure. It's all concepts.
Sure, which is awesome.
That's exactly
and it's a beautiful room. I mean, just going in there and hanging out for 10, 15 minutes, I would
just
do that.
The seamless 360-degree around you is worth looking. It's just, wow, that's so cool.
I'll tell you another thing. I mean, when every time I go over towards – so two things. The way you get to Spaceship Earth in the front of the park is really interesting because you go – like if you're by Mission Space – you don't all that area that was where Interventions and Mouse Gear, that's all closed. So when you go all the way around by Universe of Energy and all the way around where the express bus used to be and all the way around through the around the outside the building. And then when you go past Mission Space, I'm sorry, Spaceship Earth, on the other side, you end up right by the coral reef.
Yes, exactly. I know exactly.
Well, we were seeing that before the parks closed. They had opened that whole area up.
There, you know,
it's like, wait a minute, where? How did I get here?
Yeah,
that was easy.
It's bananas.
How many times did I run in the front gate because I had a reservation at Coral Reef and it took me 20 minutes to get there?
Yeah, because you had to go all the way up,
all the way
right, and all the way around. Who knew that you were right next to it?
They're so good at that hiding stuff.
They are, and making it seem like things are further away than they are. They're so good at it.
Okay, guys.
The show building for Guardians of the Galaxy.
Yeah.
It's just enormous.
Good.
Nice. How did Remy look, Ratatouille?
I don't know that you could really see anything different.
Did you get on the Skyliner at all? Was it running?
That was the next question, yeah.
Yeah, Skyliner. Yep, we rode the Skyliner a few times. Matter of fact, our friend Randy, he got there the day me and Ian were in Magic Kingdom. That's the day they got there, and he took every available route on the Skyliner just to go ride.
So I guess that's the one place where you can see the back end of France and Ratatouille from the Skyliner. And did it look almost done? Did you have a chance to see it?
I didn't really catch a good view. I think most of it now is pretty closed in. I think most of the stuff going on is in the inside.
Yeah, they were doing the sort of the restroom area and the fountain around the corner. I just wondered how it looked.
Just saying, no construction vehicles and anything like that out in the open is like an awesome thing. So
that's right. If there's no forklifts outside of it moving things around, that's a step in the right direction.
For sure.
Right.
Before we break it, I have to ask one question, Jimmy and Lisa, because all we talk about is what's different and everybody knows what's different. But let me ask you this. What was the same and was it worth the effort to go back to Disney World?
I feel like, you know, the biggest thing that's the same is still the magic.
Oh, why couldn't I have answered first?
Ah. I should have asked you, Lisa. I'm sorry, but that's what I want to hear, because right, we're talking about everything that's different, but I want to get away from the real world. I want to go back and experience Disney again.
I think that the magic's definitely still there. You still get that feeling. I think there's some great interactions to be had with cast members because they're not so busy as they normally are. Look, I still long for a time where it's a little bit busier. I think I think some of the hustle and bustle gives you a good feeling, and it's a little eerie being there. I don't want, 2-hour waits, but having some people there gives you a good feeling that things are going on and,
things are normal.
So, overall, the music's still there, the announcements are still there, that the castle is beautiful. I definitely think it's worth going if you have an annual pass and it's
there's some extra hurdles that you have to jump over to experience the magic, and that's the reality.
I think
overall it's worth it, and I think my line is you still leave today and enter a world of yesterday, tomorrow, and fantasy.
There you go, nice
applause.
And I think also some of the hurdles won't be nearly as bad. Like the biggest hurdle to me, that the most frustrating thing to me is the mask. But I don't think, I'd love for the mask to be gone by November. I don't think that's going to happen. But I also think that the mask won't be nearly as big of a deal in November as it is in July, because it's just not as hot.
Right. Sure.
Right.
Okay, guys.
And you started by saying that it was hot. And that's Florida in July and August is hot. That's why I typically don't go in July and August.
Yeah, I mean, that's the battle you fight normally is the heat battle and the rain battle. You go there planning that, and you have so many changes of clothes, umbrellas, sneakers, and then you fight some other stuff. It just doesn't make it easy.
Yep, sure.
So what questions do you have for Jimmy and Lisa about these newly reopened parks? Because we're probably going to be talking about this the next couple weeks. So we want to hear from you. Send us your questions. Actually, you know what? Jimmy, tell everybody how to get in touch with the show.
You can email us at questions@thedisneynerdspodcast.com and email us individually at ed@thedisneynerdspodcast.com, jimmy@thedisneynerdspodcast.com, etc. You can send us a message on Facebook to the page, The Disney Nerds Podcast. Join our group, Disney Nerds. Instagram @TheDisneyNerdsPodcast and Twitter @TheDisneyNerds. Make sure to check out the website, www.TheDisneyNerdsPodcast.com, and watch the live stream every Tuesday night at 9 o'clock Walt Disney World time.
Okay, guys, so that's it for show number 356 of the Disney Nerds Podcast. Thanks, Jimmy. Thanks, Lisa, for sharing your return trip to Walt Disney World. We truly appreciated it.
It's been fun.
Okay, guys, so
can't wait to get back.
Don't forget to check out the live show on Tuesday night. Check out our Facebook pages and definitely stop by our blog, thedisneynerdspodcast.com. Okay, for Jimmy, Lisa, Sam, this is Ed, and we're the Disney Nerds, and we'll talk to you next week. Bye-bye.
Quaharini.
So long, everybody.
Kongaloosh.
What happened in the middle of that one?
Shit balls, we did that right. That never happens.
If you would like to join our jamboree, there's a simple rule that's compulsory.